Father, we thank you this morning. Thank you, O God, for your promises are yea and amen. Thank you, O God, for where the word of the King is, there is power. Thank you, God, for your word is here this morning. Thank you, O God, for you are here backing your word. Do what you alone can do. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Yeah. It's such a wonderful time to remember the heroes who stood, who made sacrifice for the safety of others. You know, it's such a difficult thing to do. But we thank God for their lives, and ultimately we thank God for the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross of Calvary, that we should have life. Amen. And that life we live, and the life we live is in the death of Jesus. Hosea chapter 12 verse 13, it said, by a prophet the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet he was preserved. Second Chronicles 20:20, he said, so they rose early in the morning and went out into the wilderness of Tekoa, and as they went out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe his prophet, and you shall prosper. Ezra chapter 37 verse 3 through 4, and he said to me, son of man, Ezekiel rather, chapter 37 verse 3 to 4, and he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord, you know. Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones, and to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Ezra chapter 6 verse 14, he says, so the elders of the Jew built and they prospered through the prospering of Haggai, the prophet, and Zechariah, the son of Iddo. They built and they prospered through the prophesying of Haggai, the prophet. By a prophet, he brought them out of Israel. By a prophet, he preserved them. He said, believe the Lord your God, you will be established. Believe his prophet and you will prosper. Hallelujah. You know, I'm here this morning to speak to people who are in need. I'm here this morning. The Lord sent me to speak to someone who is not content with where they are, someone who is not satisfied with the level where they are, someone who needs something much better than what they have got, someone who needs levels higher than the level where they are at the moment, someone who needs an enlarged territory, someone who needs an enlarged coast, someone who needs something much more better, much, much bigger than they have got at the moment. If you have got all that you need, if you are so sufficient, if you are so comfortable, if all you need in life is all that you have already, then the Lord did not send me to you this morning. I'm sorry. You might want to take a note and find someone who is in need to speak to. Because the Lord sent me to the needy this morning. The Lord sent me this morning to give someone a prophetic push to their next level. The Lord sent me this morning to push someone from that level of survival, for that level of struggle, to the level of significance. The Lord sent me this morning as a spiritual referee to tell someone that victory is yours. It doesn't matter how the battle has been, how fierce it has been. It doesn't matter how it has been. You might want to give up. You might have been written off by so many. You might have written off yourself. But the Lord sent me this morning to tell you that you are victorious, that you are more than conquerors. The Lord sent me this morning to tell someone at the verge of giving up, at the verge of dying, that you are not to die, that life continues. The Lord sent me to tell someone this morning that there is something much more than what you are looking for. The Bible says that Samuel was a prophet in Israel, and Saul was the son of Kishon. And once upon a time, there was the ashes of the father of Saul that went missing. And he sent his son, go look for the lost ashes. And Saul went with the servant of the father that went looking for the lost ashes. After so many days, they were so tired, they wanted to give up. Saul said, let's go back, lest my father becomes troubled. And the lost ashes is no longer the problem, and the father begins to look for us. Let's go back. And one of the servants said to him, we shouldn't go back yet. There is a prophet ahead. Let's go there that we might hear what the Lord will say. And when they got to Samuel, Samuel said to Saul, you let the servants go ahead. You wait as I bring you the word of the Lord. I'd like you to know that a word from the Lord can change your life forever. Just a word. Amen. One. Somebody say one word.
One word.
Just one word. But one of the challenges we have is our capacity to respond to the word of God. Our capacity to receive the word of God. Luke chapter 1 verse 45, he said, blessed is she that believe, for there shall be a performance of those things that the Lord hath said. He said, unto us and to them the gospel was preached, but it has benefited some, whereas it has not benefited others, because the rest did not mix it with faith. The word of God is meant to be received. The word of God is meant to be believed. The word of God is meant to be acted upon for it to become a reality.
Amen.
This morning, the Lord has put a word in my heart. It's a very short word. It's not long at all. You know, I'm going to be bringing, I will title it, there is all in small.
Amen.
Tell somebody, there is all in small. There comes a time where we get embarrassed by the demands that is placed on us. I don't know about you, I have had occasions where people demand me to do certain things that got me embarrassed. People ask me to help them pay a kind of bill, you know, that gets me embarrassed because I haven't got that kind of money in my bank account in all. People ask me to do certain things that I feel I am incapable of doing. And I feel that probably they were quite insensitive asking me to do such a thing. And I feel that if they knew who I am, if they knew my capability, why would they place such a ridiculous demand on me? You see, and as we walk with God, there is what I call seasons of contradiction. The season of contradiction is that season of your life where it looks as if everything is contrary to what God has said. Where you believe in God and God has said to you, God has given you a message of abundance and it looks as if you are living in lack. God has given you a message of prosperity and it looks as if you are living in lack. God has given you a message of sound health and it looks as if you are challenged in your mortal body. God has given you a message of enlargement and it looks as if you are contained in one small box, in one small place, and you are just wondering, and you're just thinking, is the word of God valid? Is the word of God valid? Has God brought me, you know, this far to embarrass me? Has God, you know, called me to serve him in vain? You know, Bible says where Dion has read for us in 1 Kings chapter number 17,
Elijah was a powerful man of God. He was a man whom God used mightily in his days. He was a man who spoke the word of God and it came to pass. Bible says that the way we know a prophet, one of the ways, is actually that they spoke a word and it came to pass. That's one of the ways to know a prophet. So Elijah was a confirmed prophet, you know, not just because he called himself prophet, not just because he was, you know, he was ordained a prophet in a church or somewhere, but because he spoke the word of the Lord, he spoke the counsel of the Lord. So this guy spoke. God commanded him to speak that there won't be rain in Israel for 3.5 years. And once he had spoken, the drought began. The rain stopped, and everyone recognized that God has spoken through the life of this man. But there are some things that I didn't really understand. That this man was so powerful, the anointing of God was so powerful upon his life. God commanded him to do several things in his name. But after he had declared the word of the Lord and the drought had begun, you know, he was not exactly completely exempted from the effect of the prophecy that he had spoken. Bible says that Elijah, the Lord said to him, to go hide by the brooks. And the Lord commanded the ravens to bring him meals in the morning and in the evening. What a great God. He is the God of the ravens. I want you to know that there are times that God will change the channel through which he blesses you, but he remains the source always. He is always the source. Your salary is not your source. You must recognize that. Your business is not your source. You must recognize that the Lord is your sufficiency. The Lord is your source for you to go far in this life. If you are believing in your salary, you are wrong. If your faith is in your business, you are wrong. If your faith is in what your husband or your wife or whoever else, you are wrong. We must believe in God because he is the God of the ravens. He commanded the ravens to feed Elijah for some time. The ravens brought the food in the morning and in the evening. Ravens are naturally stingy animals that don't even want to provide for their young ones. But the Lord commanded the ravens to feed Elijah. I want you to know that when the Lord wants to bless you, he preaches protocols. When the Lord wants to bless you, he does not need to consult natural circumstances. When the Lord wants to bless you, natural laws are suspended. So the ravens fed the man of God for some time, and it came to a point. The Lord spoke to him again. I want you to know that there are times that brooks will dry in our lives, and we need to listen to the voice of God. One of the things that is very important in the life of a Christian is your ability to decipher the season where you are and to understand that a particular season is about to end. But you can remain in a season that God has moved from. Yes. You know, the Lord said to Elijah, you are no longer going to be fed by the rebels. The Lord may be asking you to move from that church to another one. But you are so conscious of security. You are so conscious of what you want to do. You are so conscious of your paycheck. We need to listen to the voice of God. At a point, God was saying to me, I was doing a job, I was doing a business. And God said to me, stop now. You know, and God spoke to my wife as well, said, you need to stop. You bet. My wife was not working to stop. I'm going to stop this job. You know, I've not got something else that's going to be bringing money. So how am I going to stop? And to be fair, I was, you know, kind of disobedient to the Lord. I was for a long time. But I kept praying, God have mercy on me. The more I tried to ignore the voice, the stronger the voice became. And it got to a point. I still continued. You know, I did a particular job, you know, that I was meant to be paid for. And the payment wasn't coming through, and my bills were piling up. And God said to me, yes, you believe in your job. It was at that point, while I was waiting for the payment, I stopped the job. You know, within that week that I stopped, the payment was paid. Hallelujah. And God began to open some other doors that was much more better than the ones I had and less stressful. Because when God wants to change a season, the transition might mean that there is a temporal challenge that you need to go through. So God said to Elijah, now, no more ravens, in case you think it's about ravens. Now you go to a widow in Zarephath. I have commanded her to feed you. Now, if I were to be in the position of Elijah, I would be so embarrassed. I was going to ask the Lord, does being your prophet signify humiliation? Does being your prophet take away human dignity? Why should I have to go to a widow to be fed? Lord, why can't you just do something more dignifying? But that's how the Lord wants to do it. And Bible says, you know, at times, it's not just about us. It's not just about our needs. It's also because of other things that God wanted to do. I mean, God wants to do in the lives of others. It was not just about Elijah being fed. It was also about what God wanted to do in the life of the widow of Zarephath.
That's right. Amen.
I want you to know that anytime God has a need, it's not just about the need of God. It's about God wanting to meet your own need. People always tell us that God will meet you at the point of your need. But God said to me, not actually. More often than not, I meet people at the point of their seed.
Yes.
Not their need, at the point of their seed. I want you to know that whatever you're believing God for, whatever you are desiring, God has already placed something in your life that represents a seed that can realize what you're desiring, what you're believing God for. So Elijah got to the widow of Zarephath. And this was a woman who had the flour that was just enough to feed her and her son, and they didn't know what life was going to be after that. In fact, they were already expectant that they were going to die after having the meal. And Elijah arrives and says, can you get me a cup of water? Okay, that is fair enough. I might be able to get you a cup of water. The woman, of course, was being generous. And she was on her way. As if Elijah was so insensitive, and he requested again, can you bring me bread as well? You know, there are times that God asks us to go all the way. God asks us to do things. God places demand on us that looks quite ridiculous, that looks quite insensitive, that looks as if God doesn't know what we are going through, that God doesn't know our circumstances. You know, the richest man in the world, Bill Gates, is now worth about $8.7 billion. And actually, his earning means that he earns like over $120 every second. And you know what that means? If Bill Gates' $100 bill falls to the ground, he doesn't need to pick it. Why should you pick it? Because it takes you more than a second to pick it $100, and in a second you earn $120. He doesn't need to pick it. You know, and I'm just thinking that if God needs to fulfill, to carry on a project using money, and he's the God of universe, the hearts of the kings are in his hands. He is sovereign. It means he can do all things, anything. So why can't he just knock Bill Gates' heart and say, $3 million pounds now? I said, I want to use 3 million. Bring it out. Now, Bill Gates, it shouldn't be a big deal for Bill Gates. So I was thinking that in the days of Elijah as well, if rationality was to be in place, the widow of Zarephath wasn't the right person to feed Elijah. But God wanted to use her.
Amen.
What she had was so small and not enough. And Elijah and he said, man of God, you know, I believe in God. I'm a generous woman. As the Lord liveth. It means that the Lord, when they said as the Lord liveth in Israel, it means that God is my witness.
Yes.
So God is my witness. All I have is just enough for me and my son to eat once, and we're going to die. And Elijah said, another ridiculous thing, quite insensitive. Probably some of us will at that point want to give him the biggest blow of his life. Say, make for me frost. Such a selfish demand. Make for me frost. Not even make for the little boy first. Make for me frost. The Lord, become judge. The Lord is asking us in this season, make for me first. Make for me first. And the woman, at that point, she didn't see anything again. What level of faith? You see, at times we want to be practical, which is okay. We want to be logical. But I like us to know that earthly practicalities can be a hindrance to heavenly possibilities. I say, okay, let me make for you. We need to be a church that take God for his word. We need to be a church that wants to go all the way as the Lord commands. I need to be a Christian that obey God in all things. Oftentimes, God speaks to instruct and not to explain. But we want him to explain.
Yep.
If I was the one there, with my analytical sense, I will ask the prophet, what are you up to, man of God, anyway? Can you explain to me why God wants to do this? There are times that God speaks through people, they themselves, they don't even understand what God is saying, but they just know that God is saying it. Elijah might not be able to answer that question. But the woman saw beyond Elijah to recognize the God that was speaking through him. One of the things that hinder people from embracing the word of God is what I would call the spirit of familiarity. You know this person very well. You see him every day. You see her every day. So when the Lord is speaking, you don't want to embrace the word of God. You are looking at it from the point of that person speaking to you. But when someone is speaking the word of God, they are not on their own. God is speaking through them. I speak to you this morning that there is all in your small. So this woman said, all I have is small. And Elijah said, make for me first. And she went, and Elijah said, as the Lord liveth, as the Lord liveth. This law will not run out. The oil The jars of oil will not dry until the Lord sends rain. You see, anytime the Lord asks you to produce fruit, becomes the right season to produce fruit. When Jesus looked at the fig tree, you know why Jesus caused the fig tree? I would look at it that it was unfair to cause the fig tree. But as I try to look at the Bible, I understand why Jesus caused the fig tree. It was not actually the season for the fig tree to produce fruit. But why Jesus caused the fig tree is this. Although it was not naturally the season for the fig tree to produce fruit, because God was demanding fruit, because God was expecting fruit from the tree, then it becomes the right season. And for the tree not to produce in that season, it becomes wrong. And that's why Jesus caused the fig tree. I want you to know that whatever God is demanding you to do is what you are capable of doing. It doesn't matter what your circumstances are saying. It doesn't matter what your bank account is saying. It doesn't matter what your realities are. If God is asking us to do it, we have got what it takes to do it. So the woman went, made it for Elijah first. Made it for Elijah first. And Elijah ate. And as long as the drought was still on, the flour did not finish. The jars of oil did not dry up. According to the word of the Lord. Because church, I prophesy this morning, as you commit to meeting the demands of God, God will turn your small to all. You see, some of us will start, you know, from the point of sacrifice. And later, you know, what you are giving out of sacrifice will become something out of abundance. You know what I mean? You have got £100 left. That's all you've got. And you want to give the £100. Few months down the line, that £100 will not be all again. It will be maybe something you are giving out of 1,000, something you are giving out of 2,000. Believe the Lord, your God. You will be established. Believe his prophet, and you will prosper. He said, they built and they prosper, as Haggai prophesied. Let us get ready to prosper. Let us get ready to step to that level of affluence. You know, there are dimensions of influence you can't have without affluence. And God wants us to embrace that level. God wants us to embrace his plan for us. God wants us to, you know, enlarge our coast. God wants us to step out. Can you help me to my next slide, please? God wants us to step out. God wants us to step out of our comfort zone. Comfort zone is so comfortable, but nothing grows in the comfort zone. Whenever God wants to increase you, whenever God wants to bless you, he takes you out of your comfort zone. He takes you out of the place you have been so comfortable, the place you don't want to move from, the place you think if you move from there, something bad is going to happen to you. If you move from there, you are going to die. If I make this food for you, my son and I are going to die. God wants you to step out from there. You know, God wants some of us to overcome greed. Greed. Giving is a proof that someone has overcome greed. That devil that tells you that you can write some amount of check for God, you must put that devil to shame. You must prove him wrong. Hallelujah. You must prove that devil wrong. That devil that says that you can be relevant financially, prove that devil wrong. Just do something to prove him wrong, and God will back you up. If you have an egg just being laid by the hen, you have a number of options. You can decide to cook the egg or fry the egg and eat it. But you can as well sacrifice. You're eating the egg at the moment and leave the hen to sit on it, incubate it, and let another life come out of it. And you see, when that life comes out of the egg, that life is capable of producing many more eggs. There is all in small. And you see, the way to convert small to all is this. It's a simple formula. It's not as difficult as mathematics. I know some of us don't like mathematics. It's not even as difficult as arithmetics. The way to convert all to small, just take some out of it and give it away. Just take SM out of small, then you have all. So God said to the woman of Zarephath, what you have, that this is your small, just take some out of it, and you will have all. Amen. Whatever is not enough to call a harvest is a seed. Amen. Whatever is not enough to call a harvest is a seed. You see, the way we respond to the word of God, at times it has to look like someone who has been brainwashed. I'm telling you the truth. If you are so smart, if you are so organized in your natural intelligence at times, you cannot operate in the supernatural. If this woman were to consult somebody, look at what the prophet, if it's this time of mobile phone, and as she was going to the kitchen, probably get on the phone to one of her friends, and say, I have a man of God in my house. I have a prophet in my house. Look at what the prophet have said. I'm going to make the food for him first. I'm sure the friend will tell her, you have been brainwashed.
Scan has been completed.
Child of God, you need to allow yourself to be brainwashed by the word of God. I recognize that there are people all over the places who manipulate people. And I understand there are people who take advantage of people who said, thus hear the Lord, when the Lord have not said. People who rip off others in the name of asking them to give to the Lord. But I'd like you to know something. Anywhere you see a counterfeit is a proof that an original exists.
Amen.
With every sense of humility this morning, I'm telling you this because the Lord asked me to tell you that you need to convert your small to all.
The Lord bless you.